Click the bell icon to get latest videos from Ikeda.
Hello friends, today we will discuss about the method of deadlock prevention by how that one of the four conditions that is necessary for occurring deadlock will not hold by examining each of the conditions separately. As we know that deadlock to occur, one of the four conditions, mutual exclusion, hold and wait, circular wait and no preemption, should hold simultaneously. If we can prevent from one of these conditions not hold by the time of others are holding, we can prevent the deadlock to occur. Now we will discuss each condition separately. The first one is mutual exclusion. Mutual exclusion should be included in the system. That is, there should be at least one non-shareable resources. Shareable resources are which that can be accessed simultaneously by some other processes too. Now, suppose we are considering some read-only files. If some process is accessing the read-only files, while it is receiving the request that other processes also wants to access that read-only file simultaneously, then it can grant that request. All the processes that can be simultaneously access the read-only file without hampering the system performance, because that type of shareable resources does not need the mutual exclusion. So by not having the mutual exclusion property and avoiding it cannot give us the prevention from deadlock, because some resources are intrinsically non-shareable, like a mutex cannot be shared between processes, and that it will be always considered as a non-shareable resource. So we cannot prevent it by just avoiding the mutual exclusion gateway. Next condition is hold and wait. We can prevent the hold and wait condition to not occur by examining a situation where a process is holding a resource, then it cannot request for another resource to be allocated. Suppose a request can be only made while a request and the process is not allocating any other resources. One way to implement this method is, if a process is requesting for some resources, then all the resources should be resources request and allocated to the particular process before it is starting any execution. We can done it by putting the system calls for requesting and allocating preceding to any other system calls. Now, another approach is that we will allocate resources to a process only when it has none of it allocated to it. Suppose the process is allocated some resources, it will operate it or use it and then release it. After that only new resources can be requested by the process. So if a process is requesting for some resources, then it should not hold any other allocating resources with it. To illustrate the difference between these two additional approaches, we are considering a system where a process wants to copy first from the DVD drive to the disk on the file and then prints the result to the printer. Now, we can do this with two approaches. First, the DVD drive, the disk drive and the printer, all of three are allocated to the processes, and then only it starts its execution first from copying the DVD drive to the data on the disk file and then prints the result on the printer. But in this way, we are not using the printer for the first period of execution, as it is needed only in the last time, but it has been allocated till when the DVD drive and disk drive are only in use. The second approach is that first the process is requesting for the DVD drive and the disk drive. First it copies the data from the DVD drive to the disk drive. Then it releases both the resources. When it has none of the resources allocated to it, then it can again request for the disk drive and the printer and makes the output of the disk drive to printer by printing it the result. Now only this can be done only if we can assure that the DVD drive and disk drive data are already will be there when we are releasing it and again acquiring the resources. Both these protocols have two main disadvantages. Number one is the low utilization of CPU resources. That is, in the first case, the printer was acquired at the first or beginning of the execution, but it has not used while the copying of data is being made to the DVD drive to the disk drive. Now, the CPU utilization becomes very low because the printer was unused for the section of time. But we can release the resources and again gain control, but data inconsistency possibility is there because the disk drive, when you are releasing it and again acquiring it, the data may not be same too. So if we can assure that the data is same while releasing and again acquiring, then we can use this procedure. And the second one is the servicing problem. When the process is releasing and terminating and again requesting for some other resources, then it can go to starve to death because all of the resources are not available because some of the resources are allocated to other resources or processes or tasks that has been waiting for another long time. So in this way, the process will starve to starve until and unless the resources being freed from these other processes. But along with this way, we can use this hold and wait condition not to hold by these two approaches. The next one is the no preemption condition. The no preemption condition is a resource cannot be preempted by a process while it is allocated to another process and it is operating on that resource and not releasing it voluntarily or by terminating. Now we can use this condition not to hold by adding the no preemption method. Now we can use some protocols that will help us not to hold this condition. The first one is, if a process is waiting for some processes that is being allocated to another processes, then the processes that is allocated to the requesting process will be then preempted and given to the next processes which is desired by it. In simple words, the resources are preempted from implicitly. The preempted resources and then added to the list of the resources that the process is actually requesting. Now the process can restart its execution only if it gains the control over the requesting processes, that is the resources which is being requested, along with the old resources that was being preempted from it. Another approach is that when a process is requesting for some resources and if it is available, then allocate the resources to the processes. If it is not allocated, then the operating system must check that if it is allocated to any other process which is additionally requiring or requesting for some resources, that is also being allocated to another resources. So the chain of waiting makes the preemption of resources from the waiting process and give it to the desired or requesting process. Now the process can finish its execution with the requesting process and the allocated process is have. Now if the resources are not available and also not allocated to some waiting resources, then the requesting process must wait. Now two situations can arise. If a process is requesting for some resources and they are not allocated to it and waiting for it, then the process's resources that is waiting can be preempted and given to any other resources processes. But it should only done if any other process is actually desiring the resources that is being allocated to the waiting process. Now, after finishing the resources, it will be added again to the waiting processes. So the waiting processes can resume its execution after it gains the old processes resources allocation along with the process requesting resources it was been. Now this scheme can be applied to the resources whose state can be saved and restored later very easily, like the CPU cycles or memory spaces. But it cannot be applied to some resources such as logical on of semaphore and mutex logs. Now the next condition we are talking about is the last condition is very important, is the circular wait condition. So a situation where a circular condition wait will not occur is to define the total ordering of all resource types predeterminedly by the execution of the processes. Now, if a process is requesting a resources, then it is to be ensured that the request is done in an increasing enumerated way. For example, if we consider a set of resources from R1, R2 to Rn, then each resource type is given an integer unique value so that it can be done the request on an enumerated increasing order. And the general function can be written by, here R is the number or resource types and n is the natural number. Now R belongs to any number of n so that it can be put in a proper ordering. Suppose that their systems is having three resource type, tape drives, magnetic disk and printers, and the numbering is done like so here you can see that tape drive will occur first, after that in somewhere in the disk will occur, and after that at last or at the lasting end the printer will occur. Now in this way, if a process has to request a tape drive and a printer, then it first made the request for the tape drive and then for the printer only. While the request is being done simultaneously, then also this ordering should be maintained to not get in a circular wet condition. Now two protocols can be defined from this. If a process, say PI, is requesting for a resource RI of ith number, and again it is requesting for a resource RJ, then it should be done for not holding the circular wet with the condition. That is, we have told that the tape drive should be occurred first before the printer, and the printer's number is should be always greater than the tape drive's increasing order. Now another condition is that when a process is requesting a resources that is being allocated to another process, say PJ, and it is released by that resources, and the process PI is requesting for a process RJ, and it is requesting a resources that is being released by another process, that is RI, then this should condition be maintained. That is, RI which was released by any other process should have the greater number than RJ which is newly requesting resources by the processes. Now we have to note that if several instances of single resource type is being requested by a process, then a single request for each of the request resources to be done by the processes. Now, if these two protocols can be applied, then we can assure that no circular wait condition will hold. Now, to prove that, we can done it in a reverse order. We are assuming that a set of processes, say PI to PN, is already having a circular wait. We have to prove that this condition cannot hold in a circular wait. From this PI to PN, as it is in the circular wait condition, as PI is requesting for some resources RI which is being allocated to a process PI plus 1 and which is again requesting for a resource RI plus 1, then the ordering should be made like this one. That is, F of RI should be less than F of RI 1 per all I in that process state. Now, if it is done, then we know that FR0 is always less than FR1. But FR0 is less than FR1, that is less than FR2, and dot dot that is less than FRN, which is again less than FR0 if there exists a circular wet condition. But it cannot be implemented trivially because the condition, this one cannot hold, because it is not possible. The circular wait is not holding if we are implying the previous two protocols. We can accomplish this scheme by the application programs that we use to use the synchronized object request. We can make the request for the synchronized object, suppose for a mutex or semaphore, in an increasing order. Thus, any order of the system, which is first being done, say first mutex and then second mutex, then we cannot reverse the integer number declaration. Suppose first mutex is the first one to be requested and second mutex is the second one to be requested, then no process can go out of this lock acquiring out of control. Also note that this function f should be defined in the normal usage order of the operating system. Suppose that a process is requesting for a disk drive and a printer, then obviously the disk drive should be requested first before the printer, because in an operating system, the disk drive operates first and then the printer operates. So this normal usage should be maintained by this function. We will now construct a program which can deadlock occurrence of evidence, and the circular weight cannot hold on this application because of the two protocols will be implied to it. We are considering two threads in this function and two mutex locks that will be allocated to these threads. Here we can see that the first thread is acquiring the mutex lock, the first mutex first and then the second mutex using the pthread mutex lock function. Here the ordering is maintained because of the protocols are implied to it. Now it will do some work and exit mutex operation and then unlock it. As we can see here that the second protocol is also applied because the second mutex is released first and the first mutex is released next. Conditions applying that the ri is greater than fr of I plus 1. Now, if these two conditions are satisfied, then circular weight is not holding for this pthread 1. Now, this example is containing another thread 2. We will see that what happens to the another thread. Here we can see that the thread 2 tries to acquire the lock, the second mutex first, and then it tries to acquire the lock on the first mutex. But this will go out of ordering. As the first mutex has the higher integer number and the second mutex is having the lower integer number. So the first mutex need to be acquired first before acquiring the second mutex. So here the deadlock will occur. But it will depend on how the unlocking is done. Here in the next part also we can see that the first mutex is unlocked first and then the second mutex is unlocked. That cannot be done because f of the second mutex is greater than equals to f of the first mutex. So it has to be the first mutex unlocked then the second mutex. So the entire thread will make the system along with the thread 3-1 in a deadlock state. Although ensuring the resources should be requested in a proper order by the application developer only, which is ordering in maintained operating system, but the application program should write how to ensure this ordering. But some softwares are present there in the operating system, like in Linux and Windows operating system, which provides that verification that it is the ordering maintained or not. If the lock is out of order requested, then it places a warning message that the lock is gone out of ordering and places an immediate action. Such a software verifier, which is used by the BSD versions of Unix, that is a free BSD, is called a witness. Witness uses the mutex lock to protect the system, and the lock controlling of ordering can be done in dynamically only. Now, if we do use the witness in this following code of section that we have mentioned, that the first mutex, it should acquire the lock before and after second mutex is done. Now, as thread 2 is doing and requesting for some out of ordering locking request, then it will not grant and tell the system that the deadlock can occur from there. We also take an important note that the system cannot guarantee that the deadlock will not occur is this using two protocols, but the locks can be granted dynamically. For example, if we consider a system that is transferring funds between two accounts. Now, the mutex lock is associated with each account, and the following code now we will discuss is happening. Here we are using a transaction function. We are having two accounts from and to, and an amount to be passed as a parameter. Now we are declaring two mutex locks, lock 1 and lock 2, that is to be associated with the following accounts. We are acquiring the locks using the getLock function on the two accounts from and to. Here, using the acquire function, the lock is actually associated with the accounts, like lock 1 with from account and lock 2 with to account. Now we are doing the work of withdrawing the amount from the from account and depositing it to the to account. Now after the work is finished, so now we will release the locks from the accounts, and it will be done in the exact reverse ordering the lock was been acquired. Till now, the transaction function is happening not within a deadlock state. But if suppose in a situation, then two different threads tries to invoke this transaction function simultaneously, transposing different accounts. Suppose the first transaction is made like transaction savings account checks account 25, and another thread invoked transaction check account savings account 50. Now, these two will make a deadlock definitely, because first one is giving savings account to check account amount of 25, but without being modifying to the final amounts, another thread is actually invoking the transaction where the checking account is to be transferred to the savings account an amount of 50. So it will lead to a deadlock state. Why, if we can use these two protocols and maintain it combinedly, then circular weight will not hold, making the deadlock occurrence prevention possible. Thank you for watching this video. Stay tuned with Ikira and subscribe to Ikira.